Board Candidates Forum at Pleasantville Middle School. My name is Thomas Rivers. I serve as principal at the middle school. This evening's event is sponsored by the School Improvement Councils, the School Improvement Council at Pleasantville Elementary School, Lake Murray Elementary School, and Rocky Creek Elementary School. So we thank you tremendously for organizing this event. We thank you for being here, and we thank our candidates who are running for school board for being here. I'm going to get out of the way and turn the program over to Dr. Ed Mintz. He will serve as your moderator this evening. Thank you again for coming to the middle school.
Thank you. Can everybody hear me reasonably well? You can just raise your hand in the back and try to yell a little louder. First, certainly, I want to thank everybody for coming here. It's a great turnout. We've been doing these for a number of years, and I remember way back from the first one. And I just think it speaks to the importance of schools in our community, and people recognize how vital they are in the success of the community. We've certainly done well over the years. You should congratulate yourselves and thank all the candidates. As you may know, there were 12 candidates running for school board. Three of them, unfortunately, couldn't be here, but we got nine. That's a pretty good turnout. So we thank them each for taking time out of their day in this respective season. The way this is going to work, there were questions that were prepared, and the organizing committee was comprised of members of the school improvement councils, Pleasantville Middle School, Pleasantville Elementary School, Lake Murray Elementary School, and Rocky Creek Elementary School. We thank all of them for the work they did to put this together. So they came up with several questions. There were actually, I guess, about 13. The candidates were notified what the questions would potentially be. Each one of them randomly selected a question here this evening. So they knew what it might could be, but they didn't know what it would be. They'll answer that one question. They'll first have 2 minutes to introduce themselves, then have 3 minutes to answer their selected question, and then the final question will be the same for all the candidates, and they'll be given 4 minutes to answer that. Unfortunately, you know, given the constraints of this sort of format, it's really difficult to open it up to the floor as many over the years would like, and I understand that, it can become somewhat disorganized, so I suspect at the end, if there's some time left, perhaps the candidates would be willing to stick around a little bit and mingle and maybe give somebody an opportunity to ask them a personal question if you happen to have one. I'm sure we can't stay here all night if staff wants to clean up, but I'm sure there'll be at least a few minutes for that. To the candidates, you'll see across the room, there's a timer that you can see right in front of you. You've got Izzy, who will also give you a yellow card when you're within 15 seconds, and a red, and we will cut you off mid-word. Not a presidential debate. I've been told that Izzy is a black belt. I don't book it, but apparently she is. So it's your life. You can handle them as well. So at the risk of not wasting any more time, we're going to do the introductory statement simply in alphabetical order. And then for the second and last question, they selected randomly as to what the order would be. And I don't know that they really know what the order is yet. But certainly alphabetically, I suspect you do know. So first up is Mr. Rutu Bonsley. And he has 2 minutes just to introduce himself to each. And I think there's a microphone here that we can pass around, or if you don't want to come up, that's fine.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. And first of all, I just want to thank you for making it possible. SIC, the people, and you know, what better opportunity one can have in life to dedicate your effort to education. My name is Rutu Bonsley, and by the way, you know, I'll be very brief so you don't have to show me any cards. My name is Rupu Bonsley and I was born in India, and I went to schools in India and then moved to Europe, lived in UK, went to school in UK, I did my pre-fashion in UK, and then came to United States, one of the best countries in the world, you know. And the reason I say that because, you know, I can see the contrast between that world and this world. And I got married here. We have 3 children. They are brought up at Lexington. One, my son is graduate, you know, the senior in USC, pursuing his degree in mechanical engineering. And my daughter is in 11th grade in Lexington High, and we have a little one. One thing I just want to let you know that when we moved to Lexington from New York, first I didn't like this place at all because there was no diversity scene. But I just want to let you know one thing. We are, and I am in the best place, the Lexington, South Carolina, the great school district. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next up is Mr. Anthony Baracci. hope I said that properly.
Just going to stand up where I'm at. First of all, I want to say how great it is to see this many people out. I think this is 10 times we've had out two events so far. So it's great to see so many teachers and parents involved. My name is Anthony Ferracci. I go by Tony. For those of you that know me, I see some familiar faces out there. I have four children in Lexington One Schools. Two of them across the street over here at the elementary school, one in this school, and one in the high school. I'm 34 years old. I'm married. I'm a full-time firefighter with Lexington County. I'm a part-time fire instructor for the State Fire Academy. I also serve as a volunteer sheriff's deputy, called reserve deputy, if any of you are familiar with that program. Basically, why I'm running is I feel like I can do a good job of this. I feel like I can build trust back in the community, build trust back in the board, and so that when we want things from the community, when we go to ask the voters for things, we're going to be so transparent as to what we've done, what we want, what we're going to do, that there'll be no question and people will have absolute faith in what it is we're doing. I'm excited about it. It's a scary process. It's even scarier when I look out and see this many people. But one thing you'll know about me, and I will hang around afterwards, is I'll answer any questions you have. And people can take me or leave, you know, take me or leave me. If I don't know, I'll tell you I don't know. But I'll also try and get you an answer to that. So I look forward to speaking to anyone who'd like to speak to me, and I look forward to the whole process.
Is Janet Frazier.
Good evening. My name is Janet Frazier, and I am a candidate for Lexington School District 1 School Board. Thank you very much, Pleasant Hill Middle School Improvement Council, for inviting us out tonight. We appreciate all that you do. I have been in Lexington for 17 years. I was born in Valdosta, Georgia, at Moody Air Force Base. My father was a member of the Air Force. And then I spent my life in Augusta, Georgia, just over the river. My husband, Russell Frazier, is from Gilbert, and he still has a lot of family there. Lexington County is a great place to raise your family, send your children to school. We have a great community that works well together. No, I am not related to Danny Frazier. Everybody wants to know that. That's the first question people usually have for me, not by blood or marriage. I have three children. I have a 22-year-old daughter, a 20-year-old son, and I have a 13-year-old son that currently attends Medical Middle School, and he is very excited about the school. It's an excellent place. I have 22 years federal government service as a human resource officer, procurement officer, and budget officer. My father was inducted into the Aviation Hall of Fame about 7 years ago. I have been advocating on behalf of children with disabilities to bring awareness to their educational needs. I was the president of ARC South Carolina from 2010 to 2012. They are a nonprofit organization advocating on behalf of people with disabilities from birth to death. I'm a non-paid, non-attorney parent advocate. And I would appreciate your support on November the 6th. Thank you very much.
Next we have Ms. Deborah Kelvin.
Well, good evening. It doesn't sound like it's working, but I think it is. I'm Deb Kelderman, and to tell you a little bit about myself, I came here about 14 years ago. How I got here? My daughter decided and won a scholarship to Johnson & Johnson University. So we lived in Charleston for a long time, and then we settled here because I wanted to be between both of our daughters. My daughters are 42 and 32, and I have five grandchildren. I am an advanced application engineer for the Siemens Corporation. You might have heard of them. They helped create Curiosity that went to Mars. If you ever have questions about it, I can probably get you the answers. I have my own business besides my full-time job. And I have been a Sunday school director for Children's Church for about 30 years. I have been a software engineer for 30 years. I'm the one that they call when they have problems. I'm the one they call when they need a new application. Something's not working right, so they have to fix it. I get to do that. I'm running for the school board because I think that we're headed in the right direction, but I think we need a little more help, application-wise and technology-wise. I'm committed to helping our children get to the 21st century, as everybody says, but I'm thinking 10 years beyond. We have kids in kindergarten that are learning things quickly because they have the creativity part of their lives ahead of them. The iPad and everything else will fall into place as we add more applications. I just want to thank you. Hope you understand me. If you have questions, ask me.
I certainly want to thank all of you for inviting us here tonight, especially the schools that are involved in getting all of this ready. As a former principal, I know what it takes in regard to that. It takes a lot of work, a lot of effort, and so on. I come to you as a former teacher, guidance counselor, assistant principal, and principal. And after my years, this past year, I retired from all of that. I have had a wonderful experience because all of the equals except one was in Lexington School District. So I'm very passionate about what we have done here, what we are doing, what we can do for our children. In terms of me personally, I have two children who graduated from Lexington School District. We have two grandchildren, one who has graduated from Lexington High and one who's currently a senior. Through all of that, I can say we have always felt that Lexington wanted to provide quality education. And I base that on the fact that when they move to the next stage in their life, they were prepared, they became successful in their school work, their college work, and now our children are in their careers. Both of them are engineers, kind of two different routes in terms of that, but both of them have felt like they got a quality education from our students. So the reason I'm running is that I want that to continue for all of our children. I know we're one of the top schools in the state, and I want to stay here. I appreciate your help.
Dr. Redhorn.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Edwin Harmon, and I'm seeking a fourth term on the Board of Trustees for Lexington District 1. I want to thank the School Improvement Councils of Pleasant Hill Middle, Pleasant Hill Elementary, Rocky Creek Elementary, and Lake Murray Elementary for having us here tonight. And I want to thank all of these candidates for their interest in public education and in public service. I'm a native of Lexington, graduated from Lexington High School, so I'm a product of Lexington District 1. So is my wife of 37 years, Deb. She works at Lexington Medical Center. And our son, Adam, graduated from Lexington High School in 2000. He currently teaches in the district, and we're very, very proud of him. I went to the University of South Carolina, got a Bachelor of Arts degree in anthropology in 1974. My wife and I married in January of 1975 and immediately moved to Louisville, Kentucky, began studies at Southern Seminary there. And I have a Master of Divinity degree from that institution and a PhD in Old Testament studies from that same school. I worked in the field of human services for about 16 and a half years, working with a very capable population of individuals who just happened to have special needs. And that was a tremendous experience for me. Since 2000, I have been employed by the South Carolina Department of Public Safety, and I currently serve as the Assistant Director of the Office of Highway Safety. I will tell you that I am rooted in Lexington District 1, and Lexington District 1 is rooted in me. And I would appreciate you remembering me on November 6th. I'm very proud of the 12 years that I've served on this board. We've accomplished a lot of things, but we've got a lot of work to do yet. And I would love to be a part of that. And I just thank you for your attention and mine, and I would appreciate your vote on November 6th. Thank you.
Next is Dr. Brent Powers.
Well, good evening. My name is Brent Powers, and it truly is a pleasure to come speak with you tonight. Tonight, I want to share with you three things. First, who I am. Secondly, why I'm running for school board. And then lastly, what you can expect from me as a school board trustee. Let me say first and foremost that I'm a believer. I'm a member of Mount Horeb United Methodist Church, where I'm active both in the adult small group ministries, as well as the children's ministries. I'm a husband of 16 years, and a proud father of three beautiful daughters. Emma Grace, who's in fifth grade, Bryce, who's in second grade, and Molly, who's a four-year-old, who's just starting kindergarten next year. I'm a current parent at Rocky Creek Elementary School, a future parent at Pleasant Hill Middle School, and Lexington High School. I'm running for the school board because I believe in public education. It's where I met and fell in love with my wife. It's where I played sports and learned the important life lessons that you can't learn in the classroom. And it's where I received enough AP credit to essentially go to Wake Forest University as a sophomore. At Wake Forest, I studied chemistry and German. I spent 7 months in Freiburg, Germany, taking classes at the university and living with three other German students. I returned and stayed at Wake Forest for a doctorate in medicine and also a master's in business and finance. I've been back home in the Midlands now for 8 years, living in Lexington County and working at Lexington Medical Center. I'm a practicing internist, but also serve as part of our leadership team. In my current role, I'm chief medical officer, and in that role, I have to mitigate and find compromise between some 600 physicians, 6,000 employees as we deliver care with just under 1 million patient county visits this past fiscal year. As a school board trustee, you can expect from me that I will advocate for our children to become working, productive members of our community, whether that's through a continued vocational career or a collegiate career. Thank you for your time, and thank you for your vote.
First of all, I want to thank all of you for coming. It is so nice to have such a nice audience tonight. My name is Cindy Smith, and I have served on the board currently since 2000, and I am the current board chair, and I've been in that position for 3 years. It has been an honor and a privilege to serve this community, and I can tell you at every board meeting, it is so heartwarming to see your children come up to the stage, receive your awards. And then the greatest thing is at the end of the year, we've got a graduation and all of our students cross the stage, because that is our goal, to have every student cross the stage and receive a diploma or a certificate. I grew up in a home that valued education. My mother was a teacher. Both of my parents put themselves through college, and the love of learning was instilled in me. Both of my children graduated from the Lexington One School. My oldest daughter, just as a first-year teacher for about 2 months now, down in Berkeley County. And my youngest daughter is in the Peace Corps, and she is stationed in the Philippines, and she's a teacher as well, and she's teaching English fluency. And I'd ask that y'all put her on your prayer list, because whew, it's a lot to have your child halfway around the world. I am a graduate of the USC Honors College, and that is where I met my husband. We're both big Gamecocks, and I hope no one holds that against me. And also, just wanted to share with you that my husband and I own our own business, which is Safeguard Business Systems. I've currently worked with him for 12 years in that capacity. Prior to that, I worked at Colonial Life for 15 years. There, I managed hundreds of employees and had millions of dollars in budgets that I had to manage. And that expertise has really come in handy because we are a fast-growing district and a big business. And again, I just want to thank the SICs for hosting us, and I look forward to hearing more from the candidates. Thank you.
My name is Ted Z. I live in Western Town of Lexington on St. Peter's Road, and I'm a self-employed landscape contractor for Seascapes LLC. I'm originally from Richmond, New Jersey, and I'm the youngest of five children. My dad was a farmer, my mom was a nurse, and I grew up working on the family farm and understanding the meaning of hard work, persistence, and dedication. I graduated from Liberty Regional High School in Mullica Hill, New Jersey, and I moved to South Carolina in 1987. To attend Clemson University. I received my Bachelor of Science in Horticulture from Clemson in 1992. After graduation, I got married, and in the fall of 1992, we moved to Lexington County. where we have resided ever since. My wife, Michelle, is a lifelong Lexingtonian and a graduate of Lexington High School, as well as her father and grandfather. She's currently the assistant principal at Pleasant Home Middle School. My son, TJ, is a senior at Lexington High School, and my daughter, Carly, is in the eighth grade at Pleasant Home Middle School. I'm an active member of St. Peter's Lutheran Church and a faithful member of the Joyful Believer Sunday School class. I am currently serving my sixth year as Scoutmaster for Boy Scout Troop 309. And I appreciate your support on November 6th. Thank you.
How many of you knew there were farms in New Jersey? I knew that.
I grew up there too. See that? Let's go to the show.
Okay, so for the second part, now comes the questions. And as I mentioned earlier, there were 13 questions from which the candidates randomly selected. And their order is random as well. And first up will be Ms. Jean Hacker. And the question that Ms. Hacker will answer is, what will be your top five objectives if elected to the school committee? That was question number 9.
Well, I have a few notes here I want to use in regard to this. What would be my top five? Number one, I want to start with a strong fiscal position for our school district. We definitely need to use our money wisely. We need to be fiscally responsible. That is critical. There are so many needs, and we have to decide what comes first and what we will wait on and hopefully get in the future. The district has a strategic plan, and I hope all of you have been looking at that. It is on the website. I think it is an excellent roadmap, this strategic plan. And if we implement this plan, it will certainly support our graduates to possess the skills when they leave here that will either get them into college or get them started in their career. We have some students who are not performing up to what we feel like is their potential. And I think we need to continue to implement some strategies that would close that achievement gap. Number 4, growth. People just keep coming. We hear that all the time, we see that all the time. So that will definitely be one of the top 5 objectives. I think it is credit to our school. I think our school district has a reputation, and every time I would ask people coming to Beacon, I would say, well, how would you find Beacon? Because most of you know it's a small little area in the southern part of the county, and they always would respond. We came because of the new schools. So we're not going to have that disappear from our needs. It will be continuous because it continues to be one of the reasons people come. And I believe the foundation of a good school begins with the quality of the teacher in that classroom. And we have, I think, the necessary elements to recruit those good teachers. And you have many of these good teachers sitting out here in this auditorium tonight. What we must do is support them with competitive salaries. We must create a good working environment. And we must provide the quality professional activities. And for those of them who want to move on to other professional opportunities in the teaching area, we certainly should provide training and experiences. These are not all the things that need to be done, but these are my top 5. I think they're important for our continued growth, and I would certainly look at them very seriously if I become one of the school board. Thank you so much.
Just to remind the audience, especially those in the back, if you have difficulty hearing what the candidates are saying, then just raise your hand and kind of scan, because sometimes you'll let the microphone drift and they'll know it, pick it up a little bit. We certainly want everybody to hear what everybody has to say. Thank you all for doing that. Okay, second, Dr. Ed Harmon. He will be answering question number 2, which is, how do you feel about the new grading system that Lexington One is doing this year, which includes no grade for homework, 60-40? Are you in favor of the elementary schools only getting checks instead of a number grade?
All
All right, thank you for that question. I think it's important to begin this answer by talking about what the roles of a school board member really are. In actuality, a school board member has no authority outside of working in concert with the overall board. Also, our job description focuses on some key issues. First of all, we set policy for the district. We don't implement policy. That's the job of the superintendent and the folks that she hires as her administrators. We establish a budget for the school district. We do that with input from schools. We do it with input from the community, and we pass that budget in an open forum. We also hire and maintain the hire of the superintendent. We also are responsible for advocating for not only District 1, but for public education in general. And then we also are involved in contractual matters, and we deal with personnel issues and student issues that might be appealed to us. So that's basically our job description. We don't get involved as much with the day-to-day operations of the school district. We entrust that to our superintendent and those administrators that she hires. However, the superintendent and our leadership team, our senior leadership team, do keep us informed of what's going on in the schools. And in relation to this particular question, this is a pilot project that I think 55 teachers around our district are involved in. It's located in our four high schools. And the way I understand this grading system, the educator who developed it called it grading for learning or feedback for learning. And the more I read about it, I look at it as almost real-time assessment, because it focuses on content mastery as opposed to just recounting facts in the context of tests or quizzes, that sort of thing. And whatever system you use, whether it's letter, whether it's numbers, whether it's checks, whether it's narrative, the important aspect of this grading system is being able to follow a student's progress, make sure that the student is mastering content, and when it comes to testing, make sure that the facts that they know, they are able to apply and demonstrate that they have mastered content. I think that's extremely important and extremely valuable. I would ask you to remember back to your college days, to your graduate school days. You might have had three or four classes or more, and each class had a different evaluation system or a different grading system. Just because it's different doesn't mean it's bad. It is a pilot project. I think it's something that we need to look at very, very closely. I think it has the potential to be very valuable to our students and their families. Mastering content is where we're headed. That's what we need, not just being able to recount facts in a snapshot of a testing situation. So I think this pilot is going to be very significant for us. Thank you.
Next will be Ms. Cindy Smith, and she will be answering question number 7, which is, what special strength do you believe you would bring to the board?
Well, can I just start off by telling you, I love this question. Can I just talk about myself and tell you all the wonderful things about me is basically what this question asks. It didn't say, tell us about any developmental areas if you notice, so you will not be hearing about any of those tonight. I just want to tell you, I think my greatest strength has to be leadership. Everywhere that I've been in our community, I've had the privilege and the opportunity to rise and become a leader in the different areas. I was the PTA president when my children were little. I actually had a little boy come up to me and said, Ms. Smith, this is the coolest job. How can my mom be principal of the PTA? And then later, I was, at the same time, basically, I was involved with the School Improvement Council. And I really respect all of you for serving on that. And in that position, I was the chairman. And later, I was selected to go to the state board for the School Improvement Council. And what an honor it was to serve on that board at the time that Pleasant Hill Middle was recognized as having one of the best school improvement councils in the entire state of South Carolina. So that's always been just a real pleasure to serve in those roles. I'm a member of the Lexington Women's Club, which I can tell you that that's a group of 50 women, and you do not know 50 women that work any harder than that group of ladies. And I've served as president there, and I am also, this is my heart, because my mother ended up as a high school librarian. I'm on the Friends of the Lexington Main Library, where I've served in every capacity there is, and it's just an honor to be in the library and help our students. I guess my latest, greatest achievement, of course there's many, I can just go on all night,
I'm just kidding. But I was selected to serve as president of the South Carolina School Boards Association last year. And I went and actually represented South Carolina nationally. And it was just such a pleasure because there are a lot of misconceptions about the schools in South Carolina. And I really took it upon myself to educate people and let them know what great schools we have, what great parents we have, what great students we have, and really what great communities we have. Then also, I've already explained in my opening about having our own business, so I'm very aware of the importance of managing the dollars, doing those things. So I'm very strong at budgets and at seeing the big picture. And before I was elected to the school board, I did head up two task forces, which I think now are interesting. I was actually on the task force, and our recommendation was to build this school. And look now, we're sitting in that school that task force recommended. I also was in the after-school program, where we opened up our schools for after-school care, and that seems a million years ago. But I want to close by saying, I think my strongest asset on the board is that I listen and I care and I love the children. So thank you.
Next, Dr. Brent Powers, and he will be answering question number 12, which is, in light of the focus on accountability for public education, should teachers receive merit pay based on student performance? Why or why not?
So lucky me, right? You know, I think at first blush, the American way is to incentivize performance. So you look at any industry, any business in America, and a lot of us believe that's what makes America great. The harder you work, the more you get, okay? Yet, the school system is not an American business. You know, I've said in Gilbert that I really believe the public school system is the backbone of the community in a lot of ways. First, it forms a foundation for the local economy. I mean, it draws parents here, it draws businesses here. It's also the heart and soul of the local community. It's where families come together on Friday nights, Saturdays, Sundays. So think of the school district as a business and try to incentivize its employees, and the biggest employee in the school district is a teacher, through merit pay based on performance of their students. In my opinion, it's a slippery slope. Because, quite frankly, we need our teachers to work together collaboratively. The focus needs to be on the development of the children as a whole. Because again, at the end of the day, what we're after is having our kids become working, productive members of our community. Whatever that means for them. Okay? We want them to leave our school district with a task or continue our ability to get continued education for a task in our community. So, in general, I would not support individual merit pay for a teacher. I don't have any problem with putting merit dollars at play. But again, I'm a big believer that those decisions need to be made at a local level. So a principal, a department director, leave some incentive money to incentivize your department or your school around something that you get to decide. But with respect to the individual teacher, no, I think that's a slippery slope. Thank you.
Next, Mr. Ted Z, and he will be answering question number 11, which is, in your view, what has the district done well over the last 5 years? What has the district done poorly that you would change?
Hello. I feel that the district has, over the last 5 years, has done a good job in providing new schools for the expanded student population. I actually served on the Community Schools Facility Studies Committee that recommended this school be built, and a new high school, and the other three elementary schools that are being built, or have been built. I think it's good that the school board has supported and enhanced the fine arts in the middle and high school. I also see that where they've done a good job keeping millage in check and working on the budget, even with the decreased funding we've seen over the last 4 years, 5 years. I got my property bill this week, and millage did go up on school operating expenses, so my tax bill didn't go up. And it actually went down to 0.5 on the millage for the bond. So So that saved me a couple dollars. I think we need to continue to review the infrastructure needs of the school over the next into the future. Some of the things that the school has done poorly, our school district, I feel we're trying to implement too many initiatives at one time between grading, scheduling, world language, and iPads all coming in on at one time. That's a lot for the students, teachers, and administration to take. And also back to the fine arts, we need to follow through with consistency from middle to high school on the courses we offer. Programs offered in middle school, they need to be offered again in high school so children can continue to advance. I also see where we need to improve student-teacher ratios with student growth. We have large classrooms, and with schools we have, we need to limit the number of children in each class. I would want to evaluate the immersion program and make sure that it's meeting the needs of the students who participate in it. I would want to encourage students and teachers and parents to give input into policies of the district. I would limit the number of initiatives introduced in any one year so as not to overwhelm students, teachers, and school administration. This will also make it easier to evaluate what is actually working because there will be less variables in any one year. Challenges for the district will remain to be the management of student growth.
Next will be Ms. Deb Kelderman, and she will be answering question 13. As a member of the school board, how can you ensure Lexington students will be prepared for the future?
Can you hear me now? I had written this one out, but somehow my printer did not print it out. So I'm going to do what my husband says and talk from my heart. I have a master's in education for curriculum, and I have used it to write technical manuals. You might not see that it fits in a school. Well, when you have to listen to the people who use the manuals and the people who teach the manuals, you learn where the gaps are. To ensure that the kids get the right education, I'm going to not only listen to the teachers, because they have them all day long, but I'm going to be listening to the parents and what their concerns are, what they think their children should be learning in order to fit those gaps. Our children are marvelously creative. They're going to find ways to learn things even if we don't prepare it for them, but we have to be one step ahead. So I want to make sure that we not only have all the books on the iPad, because that's what they're supposed to be, I want to make sure that the gaps are not gaps anymore, that the teachers have the aids that they need in order to teach a more creative way for the children to learn, and that we're all working together to ensure the education of our children. It's not my job, it's the teacher's job, it's the parent's job, it's the child's job, and all I can do is facilitate. And that's what I'm going to focus on.
Next is Janet Frazier. She will be answering the question, what is your feeling on the class schedules the middle school students are having to do this year? There are days when the teachers see their students for 90 to 135 minutes in a single day. What do you see as the pros and cons of this arrangement?
Actually, I'm glad I got this question. My son is participating in this very program at Meadow Glen Middle School. He is in the seventh grade. Moving in to a longer schedule block can help schools focus more on in-depth curriculum and active student engagement. But the con to this is teachers must get substantial time to develop and reflect on new practices, and unless the needs of the students drive the use of time in a longer block schedule, it won't accomplish much. It has to be student driven.
It looks like overall, these long block schedules are allowing more individualized learning, going deeper and being more engaged as a learner. And again, follow standards-based model where once a student learns the standard, they can move on. The problem I see is this. When using this model, the importance of teacher planning is imperative, and planning as a team is essential. We are seeing that the kids are ending up with tests on the same day, four tests on the same day. They need more communication. The teachers have planning periods that are filled with classroom planning, meetings, IEP meetings, RTI meetings, and additional trainings that they have to get credit every year. And there's also policies for collaborative planning, which were meant to give the teachers planning time. Actually, there's a handbook to delegate what must be accompanied on these days with minutes, having to be turned in by each team of teachers. Collaborative planning times are often filled with things like reviewing video modules and written teacher summaries and feedback, or assigned readings from the district. If you look at the calendar for the non-student days, they're filled with in-service trainings and the old-fashioned teacher work days where a teacher was allowed time in her room to complete paperwork or to plan for a higher level of instruction have been cut. When furlough days were discussed and executed, the teacher work days were sacrificed. Teachers are so passionate and so professional that most of them put in unpaid hours and work at all of this on their own time. They need more support. If you're going to implement a model, you have to be the other side of the equation and implement teacher planning. Thank you very much.
Next, Mr. Richard Boswell, and he will be answering question number three. What recommendations would you give to the school improvement councils that exist at every school in Lexington 1? Parenthetically statewide, where would you recommend that the school improvement councils focus their efforts?
Brilliant question. But the characteristic of the question is quite broad. And how do I define that to myself to create an answer? I'm afraid I don't have enough time. But yeah, I always like examples. And this afternoon alone, I was talking to one of my customers, and he said, "Oh, you're running for this thing?" I said, "Yes, I am." "You know, what do you think about the iPads? Aren't they total waste?" I said, "Of course not." Like I said, the spectrum of this question and the whole area is such a broad, you know, that the answer is cannot be condensed and you know, but yet it has to be very precise in proper fashion, you know, and to be delivered. The thing is, people are not well informed, and it is a sad thing. People think they are well informed, they are not well informed. Like, the reason I say that, because you know, I travel quite extensively. I have a dedicated office in Southeast Asia. When I go to China, when I go to Singapore, when I go to Europe, I mean, those people, they have an iPad, they have a gadget that you would not believe, because this is a tool. How do we use the gadget? I honestly believe that, you know, it's our responsibility as a parent to put control. Just don't think that the iPads are bad. And this is just one of the segments. The most important thing I like about this particular position that this is non-political. Therefore, it has to be completely dedicated, and one has to have a mission. And how do we create our mission? And I'm trying to answer this question by being very, very careful. How do we build a bridge? As a member, we must not forget that this is a bridge building process. And you know, our goal and the SIC, the entire area between the schools, you know, we must not forget how can we build a bridge. Now, Lexington School District is quite known and people are moving. I mean, you know, with these two people and the educators, they must have done something right. You know, in order to, that's why we are here, that's why we have excellent people, great community. And I myself, we moved here to Lexington because of the school district. So, be open, think out of the box, create a better society, and try to achieve a common goal for our students. Thank you.
Last of this first round is Mr. Anthony Ferracci, and he will be answering question number 8, which is, describe your personal experience and involvement with public schools in the past 5 years that qualifies you as a school committee member.
Well, you know, when I read this, the first thing I thought was, well, I've got 4 kids in school. And then the more I thought about it, I kind of realized, so what? Having 4 kids in the school was the same thing. And from my career, saying your house burned down, you don't have to do my job and be a firefighter. So my personal opinion, I got to thinking, that's probably not enough. So what got me thinking about it more was, as our kids got more involved in the school system, I realized this was a much better place for us, and I was glad we had moved here. We had lived in Charlotte for almost 5 years, and one of the reasons we ultimately left there is we just decided this was not where we were going to raise our children. I dealt with kids on a daily basis there as a police officer, and I realized that's just not the place I wanted to be. So when we moved here, I realized this was a really good school district. And I started a career with the fire service in 2008, and because of my schedule, I don't work a lot, to be honest with you. I work 10 days a month. So I began to think, all my kids are in school now, maybe I should do something. So I became a substitute teacher, because, hey, I think I can, right? It's easy, right? Teaching's easy, right? Some little part of me, I think, when I'm too old to get on a fire truck, I think this is really what I want to do. I like education. So I became a substitute teacher, mostly in the high schools, but a little bit in middle school. I served here one time, and it's an eye-opening experience. What y'all do, and I say y'all because I know there's a lot of teachers here, is incredible. At whatever level you're teaching at, it's very eye-opening. And another thing is, you get to go back in the teacher's lounge, which is like something I never got to do as a kid. And part of that is, it's just like the fire department, and Perry Theory from the fire service too will tell you, when you get a bunch of people together, away from everyone else, then you hear the things that are going good, but mostly the things that aren't going good. And so I got to hear a little bit of that, and I thought, well, I think really my wife was really happy when I actually called on the phone and said, I'm running for school board. And I think she was happy because she was sick of hearing me complain about something. She wants me to get involved. So when you get to the point where you can listen to teachers and hear what they have to say, it's very eye-opening. And I encourage anyone that ever has an opportunity to be a substitute teacher to listen to what the problems are. And that's something that I'm going to bring to it. Like I said, I don't work a lot. If I'm elected to this position, I'll be in these schools. It may not be within the realm of my responsibility, but I'll be here. And with my experiences with dealing with kids, I deal with them in the sheriff's department, I deal with them in public education, with the fire department. Kids have a lot more struggles going on than we realize. So I also see the stuff that happens outside of the school. Some things teachers may see, some of them won't. So I think in my limited professional experience, the years I have, I've dealt with a lot of children, and I've also dealt with a lot of professionals in the school system. And I think I have a good understanding of what they're facing, but I also have a passion to make things better than they could be. A passion to make this a model for the whole nation.
Thank you. Concludes the first segment. Now for the final segment, all the candidates will answer the same question.
In the interest of time, I'm only going to read it once, which is really important.
They'll each have 4 minutes to answer the question. And again, they were selected in a random order. The question is, why do you believe that you are the best qualified candidate? What experiences do you have that would make you an effective Lexington 1 school board member? Why should you get our vote? First answer will be Ms. Smith.
Well, again, thank you for having us. I've been a leader in our district, and I can honestly say that every decision I have made, I have always considered our children first. I've always been mindful of the budget, and I've always been mindful of what the community thinks about those decisions. But I know that people move here because they want the best for their children, and I do too. And I feel so good about the education my own children got. I have worked tirelessly in this position. I have never missed a school board meeting in 12 years. I have attended 144 meetings. And I'd like to brag on Dr. Hartman. He has not missed a school board meeting. That is how seriously we take this unpaid job. We show up and we're present and we're mindful of the needs of the community. I want to remind you a little bit about why this job is so big.
In Lexington 1, 83 cents of every dollar from the taxpayer is spent in the classroom. 17 cents is basically spent turning on the power, turning on the water, paying our administrators. By law, we're only required to spend 70 cents of every dollar in the classroom. And you can see that Lexington 1 far exceeds that number. I'm just so proud of our accomplishments. We now have 23,000 students. We have 3,500 employees. We are the second largest employer in the county, right behind Lexington Medical Center. I like to tease Brent. He's number one, we're number two on that number. And we have the best teachers. And if you don't believe me, go to a job fair when we're recruiting and watch the hundreds of people who come from Wyoming, New York, New Jersey, Florida, because they know this is a great place to work and be, and they want to be with our teachers and our administrators. We now have 28 schools, and to be honest, it's been a challenge to keep up with the growth. Since I've been on the board, we've added 6,000 children. Actually, I had somebody at a football game tell me the other night. They said, I don't know why you've built a single school, and if I had my way, you would not build another school. And I was like, wow, where would you put 6,000 bodies if we hadn't built these schools? I mean, it's just a fact we have to have the buildings. I think some of the programs that I'm most proud of are our special needs program is one. There's a conference in Myrtle Beach every year, and people hear that someone that has a special needs children who is living in Lexington, they just are so, oh, I wish that could be me. And we actually have people that move here that do not have jobs just to put their children in our special needs program because our system is so stellar and we do such a wonderful job with special needs programs. I think one of the proudest things I'm most proud of this year is that we had outside consultants come in and we were basically graded by outside consultants. We received an A on our district report card, and that is very hard to do. We also had a consulting firm called Advanced Ed, which goes all over the United States, and they basically judge school districts. And this particular team said we were the best school district they had ever, ever judged. I mean, that is somebody, those people don't even live here, and they rate about us. Of course, we live here, so we rate about ourselves. It has just truly been a pleasure. It has been an honor. It has been a blessing to serve on this board the past 12 years. I can honestly say when you go into a school, we were in Lexington High School this morning on a tour, and you see what our students are doing, and you see how well prepared they are for career working life, it almost brings tears to your eyes. It's been an honor. I hope that you will remember me, Cindy Smith, on November 6th, and thank you so much for coming tonight.
Next, Ms. Jean Hatton.
Again, I have greatly enjoyed being here with you, and I hope all of you go out to vote and all of you tell your friends to go out and vote. Now, why do I think you should select me as one of those four that you're going to vote for? Well, I told you that I had the experience, the school experience, and I have it, you know, anywhere from being a teacher to the principal. And I think in all of those positions, I have garnered a lot of leadership skills. After I gained experience at Lexington High School, where I started as a teacher and a guidance counselor, and then an assistant principal, I moved to Pagan High School, which is my home, and I graduated from Pagan High School. That school has a higher percent of poverty in it than any other high schools in Lexington School District 1. And we use, I think, what I will call the strengths of this district, the assets of this district. And I think, and listen to my pronoun here, we, not Gene Hatton, but we at Pagan High School, the school and the staff, changed the climate of that school. And I'm very proud of that. I'm also, as I told you, I'm a mother and a grandmother. And I know that we're going to have high student achievement. It is best coming from a family where the parents and work with the teachers and the student and their student to gain that valuable education that they need to go on into the future. But more importantly, and I kind of hate to use this word, but I still like it, I think it describes me. I'm passionate about education. My mother and father were educators, and it just, some people say it's in your blood. And when I spoke about wanting to run for the school board, they said, well, you just can't leak it, can you? And I think that's probably right. But I don't think I'll ever waver from my desire to work with students, helping them obtain the skills that they need for being a global learner, living in a global world, and getting the skills of leadership. I think they're important, and I think we have to provide them for them. When I served, of course, as principal of Indian High School, I did become very aware of what the day-to-day operations of a school, what takes place there, what needs to be done, and I think I will bring that to this board. But more importantly, I will work with everyone, the students, the parents, the teachers, and the staff. And we're going to form a team, and we're going to move a school, these schools forward. When it comes to high school, we look a lot at graduation rate, and we have strategies, and we know how to do it, and we want to get all of our students with those skills, so they're going to be college and career ready when they leave Lexington School District 1. I offer myself to you and will accept your vote. Thank you.
Next is Ms. Janet Frazier.
Good evening. Thank you again for having us here tonight and for everyone that came out to listen to us speak. I am seeking election to the Lexington 1 School Board because I want to work to ensure that all children, regardless of their disposition in life, receive a high-quality education. I would make our children a priority while representing parents, taxpayers, and serve the community. As a school board representative, I will work to increase accountability, transparency, and provide more resources to the classroom that teachers so desperately need. They are the hardest working individuals. They do a lot of work on their own time, and they need more support. We have great programs that we're implementing into the schools. We are piloting a lot of new methodologies, but we need to also implement the other side of that equation with your teacher resources, appropriate planning time. You can't implement one side of that equation without implementing the other side of the equation in order to get the expected outcomes. And we have some excellent programs out there. And on that note, we also need to communicate better to the parents about these pilot programs, whether it be by video podcasts that are on the internet. I think the parents need to know what these methodologies are and the reasoning behind them at implementation time or at the piloting of them. And we need to restore trust in our community. And as your representative, I'm willing to do that. As a parent, you want to know that your children are safe and they will be well educated. I often hear about children that have spent 15 to 16 years in school. They've earned their credits. They've done everything, except they've taken the HSAP a couple of times. At the end of the day, they failed one portion of it. When they walked across that stage, they didn't get a high school diploma. They got a certificate of completion. I will work to ensure we have additional programs to assist these children and young adults to get that highly coveted state-issued high school diploma. The certificate of completion is pretty much worthless. I don't know if any job application that accepts that. We must do much better as a school. As a taxpayer and parent, you want to know that your hard-earned money is spent wisely and the leadership is conscious of expenditures. I will demand increased transparency and more communication in order for you to know that your money is spent effectively and efficiently. I would like to see the school board meetings televised, either on Channel 2 or via the internet. The Department of Education has implemented Ustream about a year ago. They stream the Board of Education meetings live. At the end, they put it on their website. Then anybody can view it later. I want to thank every teacher, staff, bus driver, janitor, administrator, and all those that have dedicated their life to the well-being of our children in this community for the state's future. Let's invest wisely in this endeavor together. I would like to ask for your support on November the 6th. And if you want change, then vote for me. Remember, education makes options, I demand results. Thank you.
Next, Mr. Ted Z. I believe I am the best qualified candidate because I have served in Pleasant Hill Middle School School Improvement Council. I served as chairman twice. As a council, we worked on legislative issues such as funding flexibility and we studied Act 388. I served on the district's Government Relations Committee and the Superintendent Parent Advisory Council. I also served on the Community Schools Facility Study Committee. I was a substitute teacher over a two-year period. That gave me perspective from within the classroom through the eyes of the teacher. It also helped me to understand the student. I will bring a balanced perspective to the school board because not only do I have two children who attend school in a district, but I also provide landscaping services for many of the residents of our district, as well as employ former Lexington 1 grads. I am a small business owner and a homeowner. I should get you wrote because I will make student achievement my number one priority, closely followed by protecting the interests of the taxpayer. As a watchdog for the community on taxes and school programs, I will be accessible to the public and will hold myself accountable. I will make sure students receive the best education for the tax dollars spent. My goal will be to manage the district's budget from growing unchecked or out of control, keep millage in check, improve student-teacher ratios, improve grade level reading, improve graduation rate, and continually review our infrastructure needs. My objectives will be to monitor spending and evaluate the student-teacher population. Finding better ways to track students through high school to keep them on track for graduation. Develop a reading success program at the elementary level. And make sure that the district's infrastructure needs are met. Even with all the changes going on in Lexington 1, the excellence does not need to change. Please remember when you vote for the ABCs of Education to vote Z. I'd like to thank the School Improvement Council of Pleasant Hill Middle School, Lake Merrill Elementary, Pleasant Hill Elementary, and Rocky Creek Elementary for hosting this event. You can find the answers to all of these questions on my Facebook page, Ted Z for Lexington County School Board, District 1 Board of Trustees.
Next will be Ms. Deb Kelton.
I'm going to start with a quote that makes me laugh. It's important that students have a certain ragamuffin, barefoot irreverence to their studies so they do not worship the education, but they question it. I'm running because that's what the teacher sees in the class. They see the student that asks the question. I also learned something else last night. I went to a meeting, didn't expect what I was learning. There are three types of people. There's sheep who are followers. There are wolves that attack the sheep. And then there's the watchdog that protects the sheep. I'm the watchdog. I decided to run this race so that not only could I watch over the education of the children and help the teachers and the parents and the kids succeed, but I could watch the dollars going down. I know we're not all happy about the prices and the fees that we have to pay, but if we know the reason behind it, it might not be as bad, but it's tough. I was raised by a single parent, and she put us through private school. Now, I can't imagine being
1950, 1960, and paying private school because you didn't feel the public school was enough. These public schools are great. They're pushing the education. They're pushing the level of what your children will learn. And if we can keep up with them, and you have a few watchdogs on your table, or on their table, or on the education table, we'll all succeed. I'm also working to get a degree in, to be a truant advocate. I feel that there is a piece missing that causes a child not to stay in school. It could be home, it could be they're bored, or it could just be they're frustrated. I want to be able to help with that. If you vote for me, I'll do my best. But remember, I work for you, not for the establishment. Thank you.
Next, Mr. Anthony Farage.
Education at this point in my life is a pretty big part of my life. I wish I could say it's been that way the whole time, but it hasn't. I graduated from honors, with honors, from high school in South Aiken. Right after that, I went to Clemson University, and I have the distinct dishonor of setting off a college dropout. I'm actually now about to graduate with my bachelor's at the end of this year. So between going to school right now as a 34-year-old man, and between that and having a job both full and part-time that stresses ongoing education, education is a big part of my life. And at this point in my life, I've learned to appreciate things I probably should have appreciated when I was 18, 19, 20 years old, and I didn't. And through those mistakes, I hope to bring about changes so no one else, especially the kids coming up, will make those same mistakes. Like I said before, I have four kids, so I have a dog in the fight of making sure this is one of the best school districts, not just in the Midlands, or the state, or the Southeast. I think our goal should be to be one of the best in the country, and have this be a model that other people come here and have real, concrete data to say, we want to be like Lexington 1. I think that we can do it, we just have to set those as goals. I also love this community. I don't get on a fire truck because of the pay. Just like you don't come and teach because of the pay. You do it because you have a passion for it. I also don't volunteer to be a sheriff's deputy for the pay because that's for free. There's a need in our community for things, and I'm passionate about the community. And I'm passionate about the schools, and I feel like if I can come in and add something to the schools, more the better. Just like I feel like I can add something to the fire service, I can add something to the community when I come in and say, I'll volunteer to get in a car and drive at night with those guys because there's not enough. And that's the truth. I'm also a fiscal conservative. I know that can be a cuss word depending on what side of the aisle you sit on. I'm not so much of a conservative that I think we shouldn't be spending money on education. We need to spend money on education, but what I will bring to it is a question of why. When we look at what we're going to be spending, we look at it and go, is it necessary? Is it going to help the kids? Is it going to help the teachers? If it doesn't follow that criteria, then we need to really rethink why we're spending that money. People would like to say, again, depending on what side of the aisle you fall on, that we've gone through the storm and the worst is behind us. I'm not of that mindset. I think we're going to face some more tough times ahead, and we're going to face some more situations where we're probably not going to get the money we want or expect. And so there's going to be some hard decisions to be made, and I think that we need to keep that in mind when we're spending taxpayer money. Also, I'm an accountable person. I've made mistakes in my life, and it's tough sometimes, but you have to say I made a mistake. I think that's a quality we don't see a lot in leaders these days. It's one of the few things about myself I can say that I'm proud of, but I will tell you, I messed up. It's a mistake. This is why I thought it was. And finally, I'm passionate. Passionate maybe to a fault. When I get involved in something, I want it to be the best. If I get involved with this and you elect me to the school board, the goals will be not to be this way, it's going to be this high. We don't want to be 85% graduating, we want to be 100% graduating. We don't want to barely exceed the SAT medians, we want to blow them out of the water. And so if you elect me, that's what I can bring to it. A passion that maybe not a lot of people have, or maybe want to have. Thank you.
That's Mr. Rutu Bonsley.
Once again, thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for giving us all this opportunity. And my father was a physician, and he often said, you must gain knowledge to give that to wisdom, because it goes hand in hand. We as a society, we as people, have to make sure that we are well informed. Information, transparency is very, very important. How we receive that, from what sources we receive that. The perception in life can harm the entire society. I'm so glad I'm standing in front of you in a great school district. For a simple example, the other day I was talking to a preacher. He comes to my store and he often shares his thoughts. And his congregation is growing and he wants to build a big church and all fancy things and all that. I said, that's fantastic. And he said, keep me in prayer. I said, I will, because we share both same faith. And then one day he came and he said, I heard you're running for school district. I said, yes. School board. I said, yes. Why, you know, I have a problem. I said, what is the problem? Why do we need all these big buildings and like big cats and all that? And immediately I asked him, do you want our school to look like chicken houses? Do you really? At the same time, you're asking me that, you know, the prosperity. People just don't understand. So how uninformed, how ill-informed we are, in a sense, as the same token. So we live in a society which is very, very different society. I took 3 foot, like we went to England one time, not too long ago, and I took two students with me, and I drove them from England to France, to Paris, I mean, to Switzerland, and to Germany, and we were staying with one German family. The German family, her name is Georgia, which is the Bulgaria, she served us an excellent breakfast. This kid gets up, calling mom, right here in Lexington, extremely well-to-do, very wealthy. Mom, can you please send me a quick? I said, you're pathetic. I said, you know, enjoy this place. How uninformed and what is their mind? What are they thinking? We want to make a society because, forget not, one thing, right here in Lexington, we will have future president, excellent doctors, engineers. We want to make sure that, you know, we do not want our children to learn something that who is Muslim and someone who is wearing turban is Muslim. Or, I mean, you know, we need to teach them the world because that is the only place. I wrote a little thing in my little folder, like, you know, that agenda, that it seems to be always like, you know, the world is getting smaller and smaller. Yet, we are not getting smaller in number. We are increasing. And how do we compete? As an Indian, we take pride in education. You know why? Because 30 million people versus 1.6 billion people, we have no choice. And I thank God that I'm in this country where everything is out in the open. I mean, the technology is there. We must embrace the technology and must not be choice because the progress is good. We can go on and on and on and on, transparency, but are we achieving or are we doing something to create a common goal for students? Because it's not about me. It is not about Mr. Herman, Mr. Powers, or all of these people, but it's all about children. If we keep our focus constant, and stable and steady, we will one day come to a point where this school district will be another Harvard in the United States of America. Remember, on the 6th or even before, as you guys are ready. God bless.
Next, Dr. Brent Powers.
All right, so I learned early on that I'm a visual learner, so I'm going to read these questions and answer them in series. So why do you believe that you are the best qualified candidate? Best is kind of strong, because quite frankly, this journey for me started about 9 months ago when I read the Lexington Chronicle that Vernon LaFrank was stepping down. Starting then, I started reaching out to community leaders as well as our current school board, because quite frankly, I think they are all well qualified. They have done an excellent job for us as a candidate. Okay? So, and it's led me to this point. The next one, what experiences do you have that would make you an effective Lexington One school board member? As chief medical officer, I'm at the crossroads of conflict for the hospital in a lot of ways. Physicians come to me with concerns. the administration and board comes to me with concerns, and the rest of our clinical staff comes to me with concerns. Oftentimes that conflict arises from a call from action. One group thinks we need to do something, another group thinks different, and that leads to conflict. What I have to do, what I do, and what I enjoy doing is boiling that conflict down to the needs. Because oftentimes if you get people talking about the needs, if you can center it in my arena on the patient, in the education arena, if you center it on the kid, oftentimes the conflict, which has led to whatever crisis, melts away. Because when people come together around needs, often the assessment becomes self-evident and the course of action becomes self-evident. That's what I do at the hospital as chief medical officer. That's what I'll bring in as a school board trustee. And then lastly, why should you get our vote? Very simply, I have skin in the game. I have a daughter that will be starting kindergarten next year. So I have 13 years ahead of me, hopefully been born. But even though there's no children in the school district. Essentially, some of my physician friends have said, well, what do you think and why are you doing this? The other reason you should vote for me is because I have nothing to gain. I believe in public service. I believe all of us as citizens of whatever local community should serve in some arena. School board, in my mind, is the cleanest way to do it. It's nonpartisan. So that's why I'm voting. So thank you for your time tonight. Thank you for your vote.
Those of you that are keeping a scorecard, that would leave us with Dr. Ed Harmon.
Well, I want to thank the school improvement councils for having us here tonight. And again, I want to thank these candidates for their interest in public education. And I want to thank all of you who deemed it important to be here tonight. I am never going to ascribe a superlative to myself when describing myself. So I'm not going to tell you why I'm the best candidate. But I'm going to tell you why I feel like I'm a strong candidate. And it's based on experience and it's based on what I believe in. I have been privileged and honored to serve on this board for the last 12 years. During that time, I've served as vice chair and chair. For the last 10 years, I've served as the Federal Relations Network representative for the board. And I get a chance to go to Washington each year and advocate for District 1 and for public education in general with our elected officials there. Our congressmen and our U.S. senators. That's a hard bunch to get through to, I will tell you that. And we don't have an education champion among our delegation there in Washington. We really don't. And we need one. And we need to keep advocating for that. I have also achieved level 6 in the Boardsmanship Institute, the South Carolina School Boards Association, which represents literally hundreds of hours of training relative to school governance, to what it means to be a board member, to school finance, to new and innovative approaches to education and new strategies for learning and that sort of thing. And that's been very valuable to me. That's my experience, and that I think speaks for itself. However, more importantly to me is what I believe in. I've told you already that Lexington 1 is rooted in me, and I'm rooted in Lexington 1. Lexington 1 and I are the same age. We were born the same year. The only differences between us, the Lexington District 1 was not born in my parents' house about halfway between Lexington and Redbank. And Lexington District 1 has aged a lot better than I have. But we're the same age. And Lexington 1 has always been an excellent district, even from its inception. And I believe in maintaining that excellence. It's been a hallmark of this district for so long. I believe in the balance that's important, that characterizes who we are as a district. Our mission statement says Lexington 1 is a place where arts, academics, athletics, and caring people connect. That's who we are. And in reality, this is not, even though we've been excellent all along, this is not the same school district it was in 1952. It's not the same school district it was when I graduated from Lexington High School in 1970. We've been able to move this district forward, and we need to continue this. Our 21st century initiatives are very important. And we talk about producing 21st century graduates. I'm starting to rethink that nomenclature there. What we need to produce 21st century competitors, because our students are going to be faced with going out in a 21st century global economy and attempting to compete. And we need to provide them with the tools for that. We can't do it with 20th century ideas. We can't do it with 20th century funding, and we can't do it with 20th century technology. We've got to be moving forward and consistently trying to not only maintain excellence, but go beyond and provide our students with what they need to be those 21st century competitors. We have great schools, we have great teachers, we have great administrators, we have a great superintendent, we have great support staff. But the most important thing of all is we have great students and we have great parents. And they have supported us during my time on the board, and I can't tell you how much I have appreciated the community support that we've had. Again, thank you for being here tonight, and please remember me on November 6th. Edwin Harmon, thank you very much.
Okay, that's it. Well, thank everybody again. I think most people would agree the most crucial aspect of democracy is the right to vote, and the most important vote is an informed vote. Thank all the candidates for articulating the points of view so well and taking the time that they hope it'll help all of you make a good decision and share the information with your friends. I think most of the candidates agree to stick around a little bit, get a little late. If you have a personal question, they might want to.